Hey, how about a grade 12 essential quiz debrief, 13 May 2021. Here we go. Mr. F production. Boom. So you can always pause this, slow it down. I'm going to try to crank this off in 20 minutes. So there we go. It was, you had 6 nights to do it. It should have taken you like 40 minutes, maybe an hour. 6 nights. Okay, here we go. You got the instructions, standard instructions. It was a take home. I wandered it in on such and such a date. Show your work. Show your work for you, not just for me. Showing your work makes sure that you're getting the right steps and you're well organized. Plus, it does help me as well figure out what the heck is they thinking. All right, so show your work. And then let's do this one. Pause, do. So there were 6 elements, 6 people. If I add them all up, it's 34 years. I threw all their ages in a bucket there and then divided by the number of people. The most common age was 7, so that would be the mode. If I want to calculate the mean, I add up all the ages. Works out to be 34 years right there. The sum of all the ages divided by the number of people. Here it comes. Here's the mean, 5.67 years. So if we weren't allowed to be different, if we all had to be average, we would all be 5.67 years old. And the median, of course, you got to line them all up in order. Smallest on the left, tallest on the right. And the guy in the middle wins. The guy in the middle is the answer. So knock off the ends. And the place in the middle is where the number would be. Right? If there's 2 numbers, you add them together, divide by 2. So 7 is the median. And the range is just, you take the biggest number, subtract the littlest number, there you go. So there's 3 numbers that kind of tell you a central value, right? The most frequent, the mean, the average, and the number where half of the numbers are more than 7 and half of the numbers are less than 7. And the maximum spread from the top to the low is 8. So that's a nice manageable group of nephews to have to babysit, I guess. All right, let's go to a daycare. Lots more numbers now. Let's calculate the mode. Well, I may as well line them all up here. Right? Notice there's 2 seems to be the most common age. Right? There's 6 2-year-olds. So that would be called the mode. The mean is where we add up all the ages. Right there, I did that already. I added up all the ages, came to 96 years. But that includes the instructors, the childhood educators. So it turns out the mean is 6.00. I did ask you to go to 2 places. And the median, well, median, you line them all up, and then you knock off the bookends. Watch this. You line them all up, you knock off the bookends slowly until you get to the middle, and there's the middle. And, oh, what's in between a 4 and a 4? That's a 4. All right, 4 plus 4, all divided by 2 is 4. And the range is like the spread of all the age groups, so 26. There you go. Pause this if you have to. Now, you could have done that by geeking out, right? There's an app that did that too. Right? Did you ever play with that app again after we did that a couple of times? It was kind of fun. You could have geeked out and used that as well. Well, to check things out. If you're going to geek out, use it to check things out, because it's pretty hard to, unless you shot me a screenshot of all of this from your phone, but we haven't trained to do that in any event. All right, so let's do some problem solving. Now, there's no one way to solve this, all right? There's usually about 10 ways to solve this. The first way to do it is to make a list, all right? So there's his trophies. He's got a football, a soccer, a bowling, and a tennis. And he's trying to decide to put them on his shelf. And he's going to line them up on his shelf. So he could put the football first and then the soccer, baseball, or soccer, bowling, tennis. Well, maybe he'll change his mind. Maybe he'll do the football first, then the soccer, then the tennis, then the bowling. Oh, no, maybe he'll change his mind. Guys are allowed to change their mind, too. All right, so maybe he'll do that. All right, so it turns out there's 6 ways that he can organize those 3 things if he puts that first. So there's 6 ways to organize his 3 things if he puts the football first. Can you kind of see where I'm going with this? So what if he puts the soccer first? Well, if he puts the soccer first, isn't it going to be another 6? So this is called logic, looking for a pattern. What if he puts his soccer trophy up first on the left? Well, then he's still got his football, his bowling, and his tennis trophies to put up. Right, so he puts the soccer on the left, and then he's still got six more ways. Can you kind of see this? Six more ways to juggle around the other three. Right, because there's six ways to juggle three things around. All right, and then you kind of get the pattern. You go, well, there was six ways if I put the football first. There's six ways if I put the soccer first. Can you kind of see where I'm going with this? All right, it's called logic. It's called inductive reasoning. All right, then six more ways if you put the bowling trophy first. And there'd be six more ways if he put the tennis trophy first. So there'd be six and six, and six. There'd be 24 ways. All right. So there's one out of many ways to solve this. Next slide. Or you could have done a tree, right? Yeah, you probably don't want to do a tree on this one. So trees are handy for things, right? So he's trying to decide. First trophy, it could be one of those. Then he's got to decide on the second trophy. And then he's got to, so you see what I'm doing in this tree? So he puts down the football trophy, then the soccer trophy. Oh, no, maybe he'll put down the football, then the bowling. No, maybe he'll put down the football, then the tennis. Oh, no, maybe he'll put down the bowling, then the... No. So can you kind of see how keeping track of all your decisions gets a lot of choices here? All right, so you could do it this way, but I wouldn't recommend it. I think you'll find out that by the time you get through all these branches, there's going to be 24 different arrangements of things he could have. All right, so you could have, so when you read off these branches, FSBT and FSTB, there'd be 24 branches. Oh my goodness. There's got to be another way to do it. Well, sure, how about if we count the choices? All right, watch this. All right, picture he's got the box with his trophies in it. Now he's got to put something on that spot on his shelf. How many choices does he have? There's four things in his box. There's four possible choices to go right there on his shelf. So he puts one of them there. So how many are left in the box to lift out? Well, there's three. So how many choices does he have for there, given that he already put one of the four there? Well, now he's got three choices. All right, so now he's put one of them there and one of them there. So he's used up two of his trophies. He's still got two more in the box. How many choices does he have for there? Because you can't have the same trophy in three different places. So there's two choices. Hey, look at this. What's 4 times 3 times 2 times 1? Right? Turns out it's 24. Oh, man, isn't that a lot easier? So if you're doing this type of problem and you got to count all the different arrangements of different things, maybe you might want to learn this idea. How about if you try it this way? Remember I said there's about 10 ways to do it? All right, so I just want to see if you're thinking, because math is all about finding patterns and solving simple problems. So maybe you want to solve a simpler, anytime you got a complicated problem, try turning it into a simple problem. If you can solve the simple problem, then maybe the complicated problem is not so complicated. All right, let's try it. So if you had one trophy, if you have one trophy, how many ways can you arrange one trophy on your shelf? I think there's one way. If he had two trophies, how many ways can you arrange two things on your shelf? There's only two ways to do it, right? Football, soccer, or soccer, football. How about if he gets a bowling trophy now? All right, there'd be six ways. Right? There they are, right there. So I'm wondering if there's a pattern. All right, let's see if there's a pattern. Math is the search for patterns. All right, let's do a little recording here, right? So when he had one trophy, right, there was only one way to put it on his shelf. Then he had two trophies, there was two ways to do it. Then we know that if he had three trophies, there was six ways to do it. I wonder if there's a pattern. Check this out. Look, 1 times 2 is 2. 2 times 3 is 6. Gee, I wonder what 6 times 4 is. 6 times 4 is 24. Oh, gee, there's another way to do it. All right, so let's see if there's another way. All right, so we already agree that there's four trophies, and we already agree there's six ways to do three of them. But what happens when he decides to put his tennis trophy in the loop? Well, guess what? There's six ways there. Now he comes along with his tennis trophy and he goes, well, I'll put it there. No, 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 maybe I'll put it there. No, how about there? How about there? How about there? How about there and there? Or maybe I'll put it there. No. Can you kind of see that there's four different places he can put the trophy for each one of those six arrangements? What's six times four? 24. So it's called thinking. I like thinking, usually. All right, redo. Girl's got 10 liters of pop for a powwow. She's got 14 bottles. She's got some small bottles and some big bottles. Determine how many of the smaller 500 milliliter bottles she has. All right. So I hope you know that 500 milliliters is half of a liter. All right. So the thing you do is you guess and check, guess and check, guess until you get the right answer. Right. Once it checks, you know you got it right. So she's got some small bottles, some of the bigger 2 liter bottles. So let's see. We know she has 14 bottles. So if she's got 7 of the small ones, she must have 7 of the big ones. How much pop does that give her? Let's see. If she has 500 milliliters, is the same as half a liter. All right, so you had to know that. And then she's got 7 of the bigger 2 liter bottles. So that's 3.5 and another 14. That's 17.5. Well, that's way too much pop. And she doesn't have 17. Bzz, wrong. Bzz. All right, so you know that's not the right answer. So you guess again. So you do another. You try 10. All right, does she have 10 of the small bottles and 4 of the bigger ones? Right, because 10 plus 4 makes 14. Let's see if that works. Let's see. 10 of the small bottles, that's going to be 5 liters. And then... that's going to be 8. Oh, that's going to be 13 liters. That's still too much pop. She's only got 10 liters. So, hey, but we're getting closer. Bzz. Wrong answer, but it's closer. At least we're not at 17.5, so you try another. How about 12? Let's try 12. And guess what? I'll bet you anything 12 works. We're getting closer. Usually you nail these down in 3 guesses or 4 guesses. All right, so she's got 14 bottles. If 12 of them are the smaller half liters, that means 2 of them, because 12 and 2 makes 14 bottles. 2 of them have to be the big 2-liter bottles. Let's see if that's going to work. If you got 12 half liters and then 2 2-liters, 12 halves plus 2 twos is going to be 10 liters on the nose. Perfect. You found the answer. The answer is she has 12 of the smaller 500 milliliter bottles. There you go. So you answered the question. And of course, you're going to check it, right? Just to make sure. You're going to go, so 12 500s plus 2 whole 2 liters is, and when you do the math, it works out to 10. So you guessed and you checked and you guessed and you checked and you did one more guess and it checked. Perfect. All right, there's one way to do it. There's better ways to do it, by the way. All right, let's watch your card depreciate. And, of course, just to give you a reminder there, what depreciation is, that's how things kind of die off and they tend to level off at the end there. So here's the way some people do it. They say, well, I had a value of $34,600 and I lost 20% of the $34,600. So that part there was how much it depreciated. All right, so you lost, what's that, about $7,000? All right, so there you go. So your car, after 1 year, is only worth $27,680. What's it worth after 5 years? Well, you know what? I had people do this over and over and over for like 5 lines. Oh, my goodness. And they were right, but that's just crazy. All right, so here, watch this. After 1 year, instead of keeping track of how much you lose, keep track of how much you keep. Right, so you manage to keep 80%, because if you lose 20%, you keep 80% of your value. Watch how much easier this is going to be. All right, so after 1 year, there's what it's worth. After 2 years, you multiply by another 0.8. Gee, after 3 years, you're going to multiply all of that by another 0.8. Can you kind of see the pattern? It's called a pattern. Patterns are math. All right, and if you just keep going and going, really what you got is Really what you got is your original value times 0.8 times 0.8 times 0.8 times 0.8 times 0.8, which funny enough is going to be an exponent. Anytime you multiply the same number over and over and over, it's called an exponent. So you end up with that answer. There you go. You got it? Here we go. Next slide. What did I do? Oh, I didn't mean to do that. We're nowhere near done. Sorry, I wish it was, right? All right, so we did that one. All right, two advantages of leasing a car. Here, I'll just accelerate them there. So by leasing, it's new when you can change it every 3 or 4 years, you know, if you're driving customers around. Mind you, of course, then you never actually own a car. Personally, I'd rather just take a car, drive it for 14 years until it rusts away, and then, you know, but I don't need a new car every time I get a car. I'm not driving customers around. The nice thing about leasing is you can decide if you like it or not. If you don't like that car, you go back and you get another one. Or if you really like it, you can buy it at the end of the lease. Now, some students said that it was cheaper, but that's not necessarily true. In fact, it's probably doubtful these days. Lease contracts are kind of sneaky things these days. I'm not sure how that'd be up to you. But it's not necessarily cheaper. All right, so there are advantages and disadvantages to both. Next slide. All right, here's Silas. He wants to buy a truck. It's $28,500, the sticker price. He's got a, he must have a pretty, it's not an old car. If it's still worth $4,000, it's probably only 8 or 10 years old, right? So in any event, how much does he have to pay the dealer? Well, $28,500, take away the $4,200 for the trade-in, so he has to pay $26,400, but guess what? The dealer has to collect his taxes to send them in for him. Right, so the dealer collects the taxes to send to the government, so you got to multiply that by 1.12. So he has to sign a contract buying the truck for $27,216. Perfect. Right. What's a good way to reduce the financing charges on that? If he wants to have smaller monthly payments, or if he wants to reduce the amount he spends on interest, rather, well, he could make a smaller loan. Maybe he puts a bigger down payment. Or he could wander around to other banks and sort of shop around for a better bank rate. You know, if you curl with a banker and go, hey, Joe, give me another 1% off, would you? Yeah, all you got to do is ask. If you just ask the bank manager to knock off 1%, yeah, normally they will. All right, so shop around, get a cheaper interest rate, or better yet, you know what? Shorten the period of the loan. Instead of doing a 5-year loan, do a 3-year loan. Right now, the payments are bigger, but you pay it off quicker. So the quicker you pay something off, the less money you pay in interest. So, yeah. So lots of ways to reduce the amount of interest. There's suggestions there. All right, do this one, fuel economy. All right, this one doesn't need any help. There you go. All right, shall I animate it for you? Let's do that. All right, I don't have to talk to this one, do I? I think everybody got this one. Oh, man, we're at 18 minutes already. I'm going to try to keep it to 25. Notice how if you show your units, if you show the units and how you're converting from one unit to another, you cannot possibly mess up. Here's Alicia. The car is $29,000. That's after they apply the taxes. She's going to finance it at 7% for 5 years. If you look at the tables, it's going to be $574.20 a month. So how much does she pay over the whole 5 years? Well, 5 years is 60 months. Notice how by showing the units, dollars per month times months, when you do the conversions, you're going to end up with this unit called a dollar. So she's going to end up spending $34,452 total in her payments. But what was the principal amount she borrowed? $29,000. So what was the extra that she paid in interest? She paid $5,452 in interest. There you go. Now, you could have done it and checked it on an app. Some of you know how to use the app. if you were going to use the app, you know, let me know and just do a screenshot, do a handwritten screenshot like that. It turns out it gives you the exact same, well, it's not exactly the same. It gives you $3 more. So it's off by 3 cents. It'll be more accurate if you use an app. All right, let's check out the bike sales. Here's Doug, works at Cycle Sports. So on the first day they sold 16 bikes, on the next day they sold 32, on the next day they sold 27. It's kind of up and down. They kind of average out, you know, some days are low, some days they're high, but, you know, there's not really high and really, let's see what these statistics are. All right, so let's calculate the median. You know how to do that, right? Line them all up, knock off the bookends, whoever's in the middle. Oh, look, there's two numbers in the middle. So you find the middle of the middle. The middle of the middle is 24. Sweet. All right, so, yeah, the median number of bikes is 24. In other words, half of the days they sell 24 or less, and half of the days they sell 24 or more. So that's a useful central value. Half the time they sell less than 24, half the time they sell more than 24. How about the mean? If they had to just take all of their bike sales, like for the whole 12 days, and then divide it by the number of days, on average, they sold 25 bikes a day. And how about the mode? Is there any one number there that seems to... Oh, pretty common to sell 19. So the mode is 19. 19 bikes. So 19 is the most common daily sales for that particular period. And, of course, you could have geeked out again, right? You know how to geek out? You could have typed this into an app and it would have done all that for you. But that's only if you're a geek. Let's take care of Dave writing a stats test. Right, I hope you know that 37 out of 50 is 74%. And of course you got all the formulas on your cheat sheet. Write down the formula. Plug in the number. You can always pause and rewind this. So Dave is 80 places forward. That's his position. It's not 80%. He's the 80th place forward in the dog sled team. All right, so there you go. And then they ask, so how many students had a better mark than him? Well, let's see, 20% of the 45 students. I didn't ask what percentage, I said how many students. So 20% of the 45 did better. And what's 20% of 45? Well, it's 9. 20% of 45. So if 80% did less, that means 20% did the same or more, which means that 9 did better than him. 9 students did better than him. Now, you could say, well, shouldn't it be 8? Right? Because there was 35 students had less, and then there was John and Dave had the same, so they were 36 and 37, which means that there would have been 8 left over. All right, because if there was 35, and if Dave was number 36 and John was number 37, doesn't that mean there'd be 8 left? So it's a fuzzy number, this percentile rank. All right, so you could calculate 9, or you could use common sense and say 8. It's a fuzzy number. If you don't get, just show me what you're thinking. All right, precision measurement, go. So your boss tells you to make an item that's that size, so he wants you to be 5.3 plus 0.7, plus 0.4, so your piece has to be 5.7 or smaller, and you're allowed to make it too small by a little bit. It can be 5.3, it can be 0.3 less than 5.3, so it could be 5.0 on the nose, and it's important to show that 0. Because by showing that 0 there, you're telling me how accurately your uncertainty is. All right? So don't go leaving off zeros if it's trying to tell you how uncertain a digit is. Right? The last digit normally tells you the uncertainty value. All right, so what's the tolerance? What wiggle room have you got when you make this piece for your boss? Right? He wants you to shoot for 5.3. But you're allowed to be 5.7 as the max. You're allowed to be all the way down to 5.0 as the min. So your wiggle room, your tolerance, your window you can shoot for, you got this window like that. All right, so how wide is your window? Your window is 7 centimeters wide. All right, so There you go. So that's called your tolerance. It's like your wiggle room. It's like your window, because you can't do everything perfectly. You can do this one here. Boom. All right. Analog devices usually have a moving indicator, like a needle or hands on a clock or mercury sneaking up or something, a car speedometer. Analog devices don't need batteries. All right. So, trigonometry. This is straight SOHCAHTOA. There's no, but look, there's a square corner, so just use SOHCAHTOA. All right, now, you could use the cosine law, and it would give you, you couldn't use the cosine law, all right? So you got to use SOHCAHTOA on this one. All right, so you label your triangle with the opposite hypotenuse adjacent, right? You say, well, I'm looking for corner A, opposite over adjacent is called the tangent. So the tangent of this corner is 3 for every 5. And then the ancients figured out every triangle in the world that's 3 for every 5, or 30 for every 50, or 1.5 for every 2.5. They actually measured every triangle for us a few thousand years ago, and they said it's 30.96 degrees. There you go. There's the answer. Next slide. Oh, this one's the funner one. Oh, man, I'm trying to keep this quick. All right, here we go. All right, so you got a side, and an angle in between. Side, side, and an angle in between. Cosine law. Engage. Write down the numbers, plug in the numbers, hit the button on the calculator, unsquare it, and there's your answer. All right, so round it up properly, 1.60. Good. Go. Bonus questions. All right, here we go. This is straight out of the workbook. We did this question twice, I think. We did it as a warm-up, and we did it in the workbook. All right, so you write down the formula. All right, so you write down the formula. So she's got a 75%, but it doesn't count for much. She's got an 85%, but it only counts for 30%. Now, I like to do that as percents and that as decimals, because if you get percents and then percent, you can get really lost if you get percents all over the place. So I hope you know that 10% is 0.1. It just makes it a little easier on the eyes. All right, so 0.1, 75%. Her 85% was worth three times as much as that. Her 73%, well, yeah, it's worth a lot. And then what number goes there so that she gets a, she's trying to figure out what number goes there so that she gets a 70 overall. All right, so what number goes there? So when you add up all the weight factors, it better add up to 1 usually. All right, so what number goes there so that she gets a 70 as the final result? Because that's what we want. So now we got to juggle around all these numbers. So I take that gaggle of numbers and I turn it into 62.2. See everything in the blue brackets, boom. And then I still got the x times the 0.2. And guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to take away the 62.2. So you know that this has to add up to 7.8. So that when you add it to the mark she already has, she gets a 70. So 7.8 is that. How do I get that x by itself? I pop the 0.2 underneath. This is called algebra, or proportions, I suppose. So all she needs is a 39%. If she gets a 39 on her final exam, she'll have a really good, she'll have a 70%, right? And she can go to Red River College. Sweet. So that's all she needs. But she's still got to study, right? You can't throw it under the bus. Let's do this one here. These are kind of fun. This is that ancient geometry from Euclid's days, 2,700 years ago. I'll just race through that. Those are the answers there. You can check them out. You had a couple worksheets on this. There's the reasons why I'm saying the answers, just to help you out a bit. All right, let's try this one. Now, this one here, you might have needed the template to solve stuff. Because look, you could add them all up by saying I got a 7 and a 7 and a 7 and a 7 and a 7. And then you could say, I got 28, so you could go add 8 plus 8 plus 8 plus 8 plus 8 plus, you know, but you know what? Yeah, that'd be painful. So why don't you just say, I got 5 sevens, which is 35, 20 eights, which is 160, 25 nines, which is 2, right? If you do it that way, turn it into a bunch of multiplyings and then add them, oh, it is so much quicker, all right? So when you add together all the shoe sizes, it adds up to 929. And how many shoes did we look at? Well, we looked at 100 shoes. Look, 5, 25, 50, 93, and 7 makes 100. So we looked at 100 pairs of shoes, and the average size was size 9.29. All right, how about the mode? Oh, yeah, look, the most common shoe size was a 10. 43 people out of size 10. Nobody had a bigger. There was, right, that was the largest number of shoe sizes. So the most popular or common shoe size was a 10. The range is pretty easy. Big subtract small. Median is going to be, so the median, to find the median, you got to find the middle thing. So you line them all up in order. You line them all up in order and you pick the one that's dead center. Well, how do you do that when you got all these numbers? So, well, if you got 100 things, the middle of 100 things would be in the 50 and a half place, right? So if you got 100 things, the middle of 100 things would be in between 50 and 51. So all we got to do is find the number that's in between 50 and 51. So the first 5 were a size 7, and then the next 25 were size 7 and 8, and then the next 25 after that were size 7, 8, and 9. So the first 50 were 9, which means the last 50 are going to be more than 9. So what's halfway between 9 and 10? So halfway between 9 and 10 is what we call 9.5. And then you do the bar graph, and you can kind of see that the mean is where they balance. The median is halfway between the 51st, the 50th number, and the 51st number would be right here. And the mode is the most common size. So there you go. That pretty much wraps all that up. All right. So I tried to keep this to 20 minutes, but it wasn't going to work. All right. Boom. There you go. Complete.